Okay, so we are now live. Hello, Ashton. I see you are the first one here. If you could let me know how I sound. I've changed my setup a little bit. I'm using the SM58 instead of I've got a Blue Yeti Pro, and I'm trying to simplify my setup, fewer wires, but I do like how this mic sounds with the proximity effect. So yeah, just go ahead and let me know if things sound good. Okay, there we go. So I'll just go ahead and start talking about it. Last night went to go see Mahler Symphony Number 6, and it was really good. Hold on one second, I'm gonna drop my shades because the light is a little bit bright over here. Let's see. That looks like it's a little bit better. Okay, so. And, one last thing to check. My door's locked. I don't know if anybody saw that BBC interview where the guy's kids come in and storm it. It's pretty funny. If you haven't seen it, check it out. It's like all over Facebook, but lock my door. Okay. Oh, it's a bit on the softer side. Let me turn this up a little bit. I don't blow things out here, but yeah. Okay, so I'll jump right back into it. The concert last night, if you're not aware, we had our first official Art of Composing in-person meetup, so that was pretty fun for me. It was about six people that showed up, so that's good, including Michael Ullenkott and David White, who have been around for a long time in the Academy. So it's good to finally meet them. And if you are in the LA area and you're interested in doing one of these meetups, I've got an LA chapter group. And feel free to, I'll see if I can post a link, but feel free to go ahead and try to join and post any concerts. If you're going to a concert or, you know, you're going to be around the area or something, yeah, just feel free. Okay, so yeah, I mean, I want to talk a little bit about Mahler. We don't have to go super in depth. I don't consider myself an expert on Symphony Number 6, other than I've listened to it a whole lot. But I do want to put out there that if you've never been to a live symphony and actually with good seats, then it's something that you need to start experiencing, especially if you are serious about becoming a composer. We were in the third row, and actually there was nobody in front of us, so we were basically, you know, 5 or 6 feet from the conductor, and you know, 6 feet from the concertmaster and first chair cello, so you can really hear all of the nuances of the timbre. And beyond that, especially if you're located near the conductor, which obviously if you're going to, you know, somewhere like the LA Phil or another comparable professional orchestra, tickets can be very expensive. So I would recommend trying this out with college orchestras. You know, find a local decent college orchestra and go to their concerts and try to get really good seats right up front. But you can really hear the spread on things. You can hear, you know, in a sense, how it's panned in real life, and you can really pick up on the nuances of the orchestration in ways that you just don't get when you're listening to a recording. I don't care how good that recording is, it just doesn't come close because, you know, like everything, you're dealing with a microphone, you're dealing with, you know, headphones or speakers. You're dealing with how the mics were placed. You're dealing with all sorts of other things, tape hiss if they were using analog stuff, or, you know, however their chain was set up. So yeah, just it's something about getting out there, seeing what real players do, listening, just really, really listening, like deeply when you're there. It's hard to explain how it is. And in particular, it's something that everybody always comments on is how cool it is to watch the cellos. I mean, for some reason, the cello it's just the coolest instrument to watch in the orchestra. you know, brass and woodwinds, it's like you see little fingers and maybe they move around a bit. And violins and violas are cool. But the cellos, they just, you know, all of them are just super into it. And their arms are flailing. And, you know, Mahler loves to use all sorts of cool techniques like, you know, pizzicato chords and lots of double, triple, and quadruple stops. You know, interesting changes between tremolo and, you know, just other kinds of techniques. It's just really interesting to watch it, and the orchestration comes alive. I think ultimately for the composer, it means a lot more when you can actually see it. And I have a theory on this. If anybody's studied any kind of memory training stuff, we talked a little bit about this in the last symposium, actually, with Moonwalking with Einstein, which is a school book about memory. But I believe that the orchestra itself can be considered a memory palace. So a memory palace being this thing where like you memorize your house and the layout of your house, and it allows you to memorize and understand things easily. And if you can imagine, you close your eyes and imagine standing where the conductor is standing, and when the violins play, or violin one play, it's going to be right here. It's going to be on my left side, right? I think you guys are looking in mirror image here. But it's going to be on your left. Cellos are going to be on your right. Sometimes, I realize this changes. Sometimes they put like violin two over there, or, you know, violas over there, or whatever. But most of the time, it's violins and cellos, right? Basses, you're going to feel them over here. Although the bass notes, if you're aware of how bass notes propagate throughout a hall, it's a lot harder to tell direction with bass. They're much longer wavelengths, and they kind of fill the whole room. So that's why they're kind of sitting over there, and it doesn't really matter. But you really start to understand why things are laid out and you know, the power of things. I mean, you could have every single string playing, but if they're playing quietly with, you know, a really light tremolo, which he does quite a bit, you know, even a flute way in the back playing mezzo piano is going to stick out above that. And it's just really interesting to see the dynamics in action and to really feel it. So that's my little spiel on going to live concerts. Now, Mahler's Symphony No. 6 is one of my favorites. This was asked last week, what's my absolute favorite piece? And it's so hard to put a, you know, it's hard to choose what my favorite is. I did eventually land on probably the thing I've listened to more than anything else is that fourth movement from Mahler's Symphony No. 1. But Symphony 6 is incredible. There's some great videos on YouTube of Leonard Bernstein conducting with the Vienna Philharmonic. I highly recommend watching that one because it's powerful watching the instruments and the conducting and everything. But it's actually, you know, with its grandiosity and you know, amazing variety of techniques that he uses, it's still very classical in form, especially the first movement. I mean, it's straight up sonata form with an exposition that even repeats. It's got a repeat sign in there. So, and Mahler has said in the past to his wife and to Natalie Bauer Lechner, or had said, not has said, I guess that would be present tense, but he had said that he uses the form and he uses the same types of techniques that Beethoven and Mozart and Haydn used. It's just bigger. And I believe we should take him at face value on that. And something I've been thinking about recently, which is, I don't know if this is true. This is just me like wishing that this is true, because I really hope it is. But if we think about my favorite author on form is William Kaplan, right? He wrote Analyzing Classical Form and Classical Form, which came out almost 20 years ago now, which is like, that's quite a bit longer than I was, or it's crazy to think that that's 20 years old now. But the ideas that he originally, or the place where he originally got his ideas on form were from Schoenberg. And Schoenberg was, of course, a protege of Mahler. He would go to Mahler's concerts. Mahler would go to his concerts. Mahler would often be the only person that would applaud when Schoenberg's pieces were played, and he would then turn around and, you know, yell at the audience for booing and hissing or laughing or whatever the audience would do. But there was an interesting story where Mahler, it was Alma Mahler, so Mahler's wife, saying that they would frequently have Schoenberg and Zemlinsky, who was, I think, Schoenberg's brother-in-law, also a composer, and they would come over for dinner, and they'd eat dinner, and then they'd go over to the piano and they'd talk shop. And I love the idea of them talking shop at the piano. I would just love to listen to Mahler talk about his thoughts on music and how it all worked. But my guess is that inevitably they talked about form. They talked about techniques that, you know, Haydn and Beethoven would have used. And I believe a lot of that percolated into Schoenberg's ideas. And what I think is one of the reasons I was attracted to William Kaplan's ideas on form so strongly was that it fit with the kind of music that I really liked to listen to, which was basically Mahler, Beethoven, Mozart, Haydn, kind of, you know, more stricter classical styles. And I think there is a direct lineage, from Kaplan back to Schoenberg, back to Mahler. And Schoenberg's ideas fit with Mahler's idea of form, because it was Mahler's idea of form. That's what I think is happening. Now, there's absolutely no way to prove this. There's no way to corroborate this. I think everybody's read Mahler's letters and correspondence, and there's really nothing that says that happened. I just want to believe that it's true. So that's me. But, you know, I want to open it up to questions, and let's just see, you know, what's on your mind. There's a little bit of hello, Michael. I can see you there. I can see that you're able to sign in. The guy by the screen name Smokey Tiki was at the symphony last night with me. So, okay, here we got a question from Daniel. Is 4-7-4 ever valid? Well, let's just play it. Let's just listen to it. Well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with just moving as little voice leading as possible. So it's going to be an inversion. Sounds fine to me. In reality, you can usually get away with any kind of chord movement if you can somehow justify it through some kind of resolution, right? Or some kind of voice leading movement. So if we're... In fact, let me pull up Sibelius here so we can take a look at this. And, oh, sorry, I will turn up my microphone. Somebody's asking. Let's see. Is this a little bit better, Jax? Does that sound a little bit louder? I want to make sure I'm loud enough for everybody to hear me. Let's see. I think I've got everything all the way up. I don't want to risk blowing things out, but let me know if this is loud enough for you. I turned up my mic a little bit better. Let's see, I think I can go. How about now? Is that a little bit better? So, okay. So let me back up here. Let me pull up Sibelius for a second, and let's just look at this. So we got once again thinking in C major. It's almost always easier to think in C major. So if we look at this, and let me zoom in a little bit here so it's a little bit bigger. Actually, I'm doing this. Voice leading wise, it's actually quite smooth. I mean, you've got a sustained note here, right? You've got C going up to D and A going up to B. So voice leading wise, the chord movement, it works just fine. Now, is it functional necessarily? Not really, but functional is only, it's like one way of using your harmony. You can use your harmony functionally, and you can use it non-functionally. You can do things that make sense through voice leading only, or you could do something that is purposefully outside the realm of what people are expecting. And what that does is it sets people up and for an expectation, and then you don't fulfill that expectation, and that creates interest, that creates variety and excitement in your music. So... But when you listen to this, it sounds like that, right? So And that, in reality, is now starting to feel a little bit more like if we were to pretend we're in four, or sorry, in the key of F, this is a one. Oh, I don't know what I'm doing. This would be a one. This would be a 5-4-2, 4-2, a 5, right? So this is a common progression in film score. It's common all over the place. It's this kind of sound. There we go. Let's see, how does it... Superman, anybody? So I guess to get back to the point is, yes, that's a perfectly valid harmonic progression. You just have to put it in the context of what are you trying to do. You're not necessarily saying, I'm going to write a functional chord progression here. You're just saying, I'm going to write something that makes sense. Now, that second one that I did, that is very, very much functional, right? It's one leading to a 5-4-2 of 5, and then often it goes down to like a 5-6. So yeah, just try it out. Let's see, how would you compare Holst and Mahler, even if that's even possible to a certain degree? I would say Mahler is he is a little bit more focused on trying to do intricate contrapuntal lines than Holst. I'm not an expert on Holst either. I haven't listened to everything. I've listened to The Planets quite a bit. And I played the second suite for wind band, when I was in a wind band in South Africa, which was actually quite a good wind band. So I do have some experience with Holst, but from what I listened to, it generally feels like Holst is more homophonic, right? Where it closer to kind of early Mahler, later Mahler. So, you know, from symphony number, I would say from symphony number 4 on, Mahler definitely says, I'm going to really focus on my counterpoint and really focus on the individual line and, you know, the individuality of every single instrument in the orchestra. Not to say that Holst doesn't focus on individuality of timbres and instruments, but the focus, I think, is a little more homophonic. I would say also Mahler tends to be a little bit more unpredictable with the mood and, you know, the direction of his pieces. I mean, it could turn on a dime. It could be super happy, and all of a sudden everything's just totally tragic, and then the world explodes, and then a monster breathing fire pops out. I mean, it's very dramatic, you know, kind of up and down kind of music, whereas Holst tends to be a little bit more sustained in terms of mood and idea. So you listen to a piece like Jupiter, and even though there are different moods and different feelings within it, I mean, you've got obviously kind of the very exciting opening, then you've got the slower, you know, but it seems a little bit more predictable, I would say, than Mahler. I love Holst too, and Holst is a great and amazing orchestrator. Okay, let's see. Ashton asks, what is your view on musical evolution? For example, the Renaissance to the Baroque era to the Classical period to the Romantic. So I think, Ashton, what you're asking is there a kind of teleology of music? So if anybody is unfamiliar with the term teleology, it is kind of the forward progress. Like there is an actual narrative towards, you know, some end point, right? There is truth. There is a place where this is all going. And it's hard to say. I mean, there's so many different views on this. You can clearly draw lines from the Renaissance through the Baroque, through the Classical, through the Romantic, through early 20th century, up through composers nowadays. And then you can also draw different lines that go in completely different directions. So music obviously evolves and changes. Whether it gets better or worse is really kind of a value judgment on music that I don't think is necessary to do. I mean, I've got music that I like that I think is better than other music. And you probably have music that you like that you think is better than other music. And ultimately, I don't think we're going to be able to convince people that our music is better than their music. So it's probably something that we should all just not try to push too much, you know, a teleology of music. However, I love tonality, and I think that the push away from traditional tonality has alienated a lot of listeners. You know, not to say that Mozart was writing his music for the average Joe on the street. I mean, he was the patron of, you know, princes and you know, the aristocracy of the day. And his concerts generally were given, you know, in the salons of the aristocracy. And not a lot of people would have gotten to hear it all that much. With that being said, though, they would publish their music and, you know, people would play their stuff on the piano. And that's how a lot of people did get their music. So I don't want to also, you know, spread this lie that it's only, you know, it's the bourgeoisie music and the proletariat are just sitting there strumming on their lutes or whatever. I think there's something more to tonality than, you know, the 20th century has acknowledged. And I think you can feel that when you listen to great tonal music. And it's, I've never had a truly emotional response, say, listening to, you know, something very serial based or very mathematical based. It doesn't happen for me. However, listening to tonality, it does happen. So now there are a lot of interesting things that go on with music that are not in traditional tonality, but are still, I guess, harmonious and not so stringent and harsh to listen to, and are very human. You know, they're based in emotion, I guess, really. So that's my views on that. Let's see. Okay. How to go about creating string orchestration for a waltz. Okay, so Ilka is asking about a waltz and how to orchestrate that for strings. So I think we need to step back and say we should probably, you can do a lot first. If you're, let's say you're writing on piano, right? You can do a lot in terms of pre-orchestration with your piano writing. And it's something I talk about in the Academy as the way we look at accompaniment is really we are not necessarily just writing a melody and accompanying it with the left hand. We are orchestrating for piano. And that's a great way to start because then you can start to really think about the textures, the timbres beforehand, and you can start to take notes on it. You know, one of the ways, if you get a chance, listen to my podcast episode on orchestration. I think it's episode number 9. And one of the better ways that I learned to orchestrate and orchestrate quickly and efficiently is to start by writing things down with words, right? So let me see. Why don't we do this? We're going to write something very, some kind of simple waltz. I'm going to try to do this live. So let me go ahead and change this. And little thing to get us in the mood there. A little introduction. And then let's come up with a melody. Why don't we come up with a melody first right now so that it's people can see that process as opposed to starting from a chord tone melody. Now, almost always when you write your melody, you are, even if you don't know it and even if you don't necessarily believe it, you are kind of thinking of the harmony already. So if I do this, right, I'm not thinking of this chord. Right? That's not probably what's occurring in my mind, especially after doing 4 bars of this. Right? I mean, you could do it. Nothing wrong with it. But that's probably not what I was getting at. So when I write a C here, chances are I'm implying one. And that's something that you have to keep in mind while you're doing this. You have to keep in mind that there is probably a harmony that is kind of the first level default. And more often than not, it's some kind of functional move. And just keep that in mind. You can always change it later. But let's see. So let's do... Okay, so I just wrote something. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that is a non-standard phrase there. It's seven measures instead of kind of a more normative eight, or kind of dividing by two. Now, in reality, it's kind of like, I don't know where this is going to go yet. This is kind of the messiness of composing is, you know, you want to just get stuff down first and worry about the details after you get something down. You can't worry about details unless you've got kind of rough stuff there. So now we've got a melody. Let's go ahead and listen to it. Oh, you know what? That is way too slow. Let me put in... Let's see, quarter equals... Let's start with 120. Yeah, still a little too slow. Let's do 135. And let's go make those staccato, because... It feels staccato-y. Okay, so nice little simple thing. And then if I go along here and do what I was talking about... And there we go. Actually, it kind of turns into an eight measure little idea. So let's listen to what I've done. Let's see. Not the best thing I've ever written, I'm not going to lie. Let's see. This at all. Let's see. I'm not liking that. And this is the reality, is sometimes I write stuff that sucks. And I think that's important for people to see, actually. Sometimes my brain isn't working all that great, especially when I have to talk about it live. And so, yeah, this is just the reality of composition, and yeah, but either way, what we can do now is we can work on this, and what we've got is a basic little thing going on, and I'm going to take it out of this, I'm going to see, how am I going to do this? I'm going to copy this. Why don't we just orchestrate? Well, I think you asked to orchestrate for strings, so I can just add them here. Okay. Strings. Let's see. Violin. One, two. And I'll put this down at the bottom. And there we go. Okay, so now we are set up to try to orchestrate. And I realize everybody's chatting, and I can't see. Oh, you know what? Actually, I think I can pop this out so I can see a little bit more of the chat. But I apologize if I don't get to your questions immediately. It's I'm just trying to be a little thorough on this one. So what you have to ask yourself is, you know, what's the kind of the arc of your piece, and where do you want things to go? Do you want it to start small and get big? Do you want it to start medium and stay medium? You know, do you want any surprises? Do you want anything like that? And I just say let's start a big start like this, right? That's kind of surprising. But what we're also going to do with immediate drop. So now I am just putting down ideas. So this doesn't necessarily mean anything musically yet. It's purely a way for your mind to start subconsciously working on things. And I think there's a lot of power in kind of posing ideas and posing questions. Jax is saying the volume dropped again. Yeah, I may have to rethink my setup with this mic. Hopefully that's still loud enough. I don't know if it is, but let's see. Do I still sound okay? Somebody give me a little bit of feedback. So I don't want to go on too much if you guys can't hear me. Okay. It's good to know. Okay. So what we're doing is we're basically posing ideas or questions to our minds subconsciously, and it gets your brain working on things, and it may not happen immediately. So, you know, to say that I'm going to write this down and Jax, you may have to, a lot of people are telling me it sounds okay, and you may just have to get some headphones on or something. I'm sorry, because I'm all the way up, so I don't know how to make my volume go louder without having to pull out an extra preamp. I'm going to probably be getting a new audio interface soon. So yeah, we want to start, big start, and then immediate drop, and then I would say we just kind of, from there, you know, kind of calmly go into waltz, right? And then here I would say violin one melody, and it may be violin two. I mean, we'll just start simple. Violin one melody. I would say bass pits, and then maybe we'll do some interesting riffle, right? Now, a riffle is a term that I got from stream geology, but I just loved it so much that I just had to use it. So the way I what I call a riffle is, let's say you've got, let's just put this here. So let's say we've got this. To make it a riffle, you just want to give it some kind of interesting little textural type of movement, right? So it could be something like this. Let's see. Right? I changed it. We've got this very basic going on with the piano, but with, you know, with a whole section of players, you've got lots and lots of possibilities. And once again, going to a live concert, especially a Mahler concert, you will see that. You will see how he splits desks to do different things. One person could be doing a trill, another person could be doing a tremolo, and then the other person doing pizzicato, all at the same time. And I just I just thought that term riffle was good for it. It's a way of saying I'm going to take something basic and I'm going to make it more interesting. Now, in geology, in stream geology, a riffle is a spot where there's turbulence in the water because it becomes shallower and the rocks make the water go blah, blah, blah. So I was like, oh, that kind of sounds like what these things are in music. So we could do something like that, you know. But it's just quick shorthands to get you moving. And I know I'm moving really slow, but that's because I'm explaining things as I go. And then for this part, I mean, I haven't written a ton of music here, but we can just orchestrate up to this point because I think we're going to get the point across. So let's see. Now we're talking 8 measures here. We don't probably need to change anything, but maybe we can add, violin 2. And now we've got something to go from here. Instead of that, we'll do cello, let's see, 8VB. So I have just orchestrated piece. Good night, everybody. We're done. I'll see you. No, I'm kidding. All I've done is I've plotted out ideas of possible orchestrations, but it's not so much orchestration as it is effect. It's the effect that this is going to have. Big, going to immediate drop, going to calmly going into the waltz, right? So something like this. So that means now, let's look at this. If we want something big, right? We'll do like a big... So you just start off like this, right? Big thing, and then we'll just get our placeholders in there. I may add an extra measure here. But okay, so let's listen to what we've done. Oops, the wrong one. You know what? I'm going to turn off the piano. Take that away. So, now I said big at the beginning, and that doesn't feel very big. And one of the best ways you can do this. Now, is that chord possible on the violin? Probably not. I don't know. Doesn't matter right now. No, it does not, because it's the concept that we're going after. What we're going after here is a big arpeggio, you know, a big like a quadruple stop thing, and you'll hear this used a lot, where you know you got the strings go wah, like that, and it just gives a real powerful thing. Right? And then we're also going to give it a little bit of dynamics, and this is where you start to see that often the thing that makes the difference is the details, it's the dynamics, it's the articulations, it's the care and attention that you give to that individual line. Now, for something like this, I can create a note for it, and in Sibelius you can do this, a new comment. I'm going to say, check, quad stop right here. And I'm just going to put that right there. So now I know that I can come back and I can fix that. And that gives me something to come back to. And what I call this is compositional debt. So if anybody is familiar with the concepts of programming and building apps and things like that, there's this idea called technological debt, where you hack something together so that you can make forward progress, you can release something, and then you can come back and fix it later. Well, I think as composers, we can do the exact same thing. We can take on compositional debt, right? I know that I have to come back and fix this because that may not actually be playable in reality. And if I put that part in front of somebody and it's not, if I'm not on axis, is that a little bit better? If I were to give that to a player, they would be like, this isn't playable. Now, if it's a pro, like a studio player here in LA, they'll probably just change it and they won't tell me and they'll make me feel all warm and fuzzy about how great of a composer I am. But if it's not, if it's, you know, somebody at college or somebody be like, this is stupid, get this out of my face, you don't know what you're doing. So just keep that in mind. Compositional debt is a good thing, just like debt can be a good thing for buying a home or buying a car, but you have to pay it off eventually. However, making that forward progress, yes, thank you, Ashton, for dropping the hammer. Enough about the mic. If you can hear me, I'm happy. So now let's listen to what we've done. Oh, one last thing. One, because Sibelius sounds aren't all that. In fact, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to switch to the new Note Performer so you can hear it. And now this is Note Performer without any effects. I do put some other effects on. So. I think that sounds really good. And in fact, see that we can let's see, we keep this going. We got that, we've got F, so we got, let's see, how am I gonna do this? Let's keep that at G. I don't know if you could do those effects on MuseScore. Let me try to turn down the music a little bit so that that's not too loud either. Sorry, I'm still learning all this Google Live and OBS stuff, so trying to figure out how all the broadcasting works. So now let's go ahead and just copy this up here, right? Now, for something like Sibelius playback-wise, often, you know, you'll do extra slurs that may not be necessary for real players. But for me, it does help at the beginning, at least, to start grouping things. And Sibelius often plays it slightly different. It'll hold notes. But you have to keep in mind with bowing, slurs with bowing are slightly different and than they are treated with wind instruments, which is what I'm a trumpet player. That's what I grew up playing. So I read a slur as basically just legato. Violin or string players read a slur as a single bow. So you can get yourself into trouble if you try to put a slur over a bunch of things. They may run out of bow. So I would be cautious about putting those in, and put them in when you really want that slurred sound between the two notes. So let's see. But let's listen. In fact, let me finish out the bass line. It could be voice leading. It can be harmony, right? It could be figuring out. It could be saying, you know what? I got myself to this point, and I'm just going to continue with it. I'm going to go back, and I'm going to fix my harmony later. I'm going to make it sound smoother. I'm going to make it sound cooler, or whatever it is. So let's see. Then we've. Cellos. everybody else. So I'm going to just call this waltz. Okay, let's go ahead and listen. There is a lot of compositional debt there. I'm not gonna lie. Some of these things aren't turning out all that great. So let's go ahead and now let's fix a little bit of this compositional debt and see what we can do. So we've got this progression. I think I'm going to do this. I think this may be. Change this. I'm going to delete all this right here because that's all going to change. So now we have. So let's do that line. So obviously this second chord here needs to change. Let's see. So one of the critical things, I know I'm not a big harper on worrying too much about parallel octaves and parallel fifths. However, between the bass and the soprano, right, if I were to go this, it may sound nice melodically. I mean, let's see. But I like that in the bass, so if I were to do that, it is, in fact, parallel octaves in the bass, even though there's a gap here. So just something to keep in mind. And let's see, what do we got to do here? If we just sustain this, maybe. All sorts of stuff here because I'm making changes. Let's just delete all this. We're past that point. Okay, so that works a little bit better. I mean, it's still a very simple, plain thing. And if I wanted to turn this into something, I would spend a lot more time on the theme. I mean, that really is the critical thing in every piece. It's you got to look at what is the core idea here. Now, it could be a main theme. It could be a chord progression. It's kind of what you're building. It's your foundation. What are you building everything off? And right now, I'm not building anything to last here. This is just an example for this. So I'm not going to spend too long working on it. But just keep that in mind. If I was going to spend a lot of time, I would spend it first working out a cool theme and making it something special. So let's see, but now we can keep doing this. We got Away. Let's mute this piano and let's see where we're at. Okay, so we are at the point now where we've got something good to work with, and we can move forward with it. Ilka, I hope this is pointing you in the right direction in terms of how I would go about orchestrating just a simple waltz. I mean, you know, a lot of it is just think about what is it supposed to feel like. It's supposed to feel waltzy. I mean, if you go listen to a bunch of waltzes, you'll hear the same kinds of, you know, patterns used in the strings and the brass and the winds and these little kind of doodads that are all over the place. A lot of it is just kind of bringing that style inside of you, right? Listen to a lot of waltzes. If you want to write a good waltz, first thing you should do, go to listen to all Chopin's waltzes. Go listen to all Johann Strauss, all his waltzes, and try to find other waltzing, other people who write good waltzes, and just listen to them. There's also Landlers. Mahler wrote a bunch of Landlers. Like the third movement. Or actually, I guess it would be the second movement. I commonly listen to the first symphony with the original Blumen movement in it. So either way, the Landler in the symphony number one is a really good one. Let's see, all sorts of things pull from this live composition. Okay. So I did say I wanted to do some kind of interesting riffle. Right, so let's try to figure out a riffle. Ilka, I think you can't post links here. If you want me to open up something, go ahead and email it to me, and I'll see if I can open it up here. So let's see if we can come up with a. You know, I think something real simple. Probably have to take away these. Staccatos, and I don't know. See, this is the problem when you get down to composing on the computer, is that your brain can come up with all sorts of ideas that your computer cannot adequately execute because of your sample libraries or because of the notation software limitations or whatever. So an idea for a riffle may be all great, and then your Sibelius fails you, or Dorico, or MuseScore, or your DAW. That doesn't mean you should throw it out. You have to trust yourself in that you've actually got a good idea, and that if you were to take it to real people to play it, then it would sound cool. So this could sound cool. I don't know if it is. This could sound terrible. Let's see. So now let's listen what the riffle sounds like. I don't know. I don't think it sounds very good. I think because it's doing a trill on the E there. Probably if I were to swap these around. So let's just hear this. That's kind of cool. And in fact, the effect that I really want is a right, kind of almost like little minute trills. So maybe if I do this is, once again, these are kind of Sibelius-isms, right? Let's see what this will sound like. No, that's too short. So let's change that to that. There we go. That's kind of what I was after. This is kind of like, right? So these all have to be eighth notes in order to get that to sound. Would I necessarily write that for the player? Maybe it may make a little bit more sense to them to give them that gap. So it may not be 100% Sibelius-ism, but for now, it's working. So. So I think overall that was a successful little orchestration of something, and I hope that helps everybody a little bit in terms of how I go about orchestrating. I have been playing around a lot with my new ideas on orchestration, and they are not ready for prime time. And it's not so much that I'm trying to hide it from you, it's that I need to clarify terminology before I start confusing the heck out of everybody in the way I'm trying to explain orchestration. Okay, let's see. Okay, I've got Ilka's thing here, so let me try to pull it up. Bear with me for 1 second. And in fact, actually, Ilka, I think we spent quite a bit of time on this. I'm gonna maybe move on, and we can probably talk about this at another time, because I think there are some other questions that I did skip over here. Let me scroll back. Let's see. Is triple meter kind of the most significant meter? I feel like all music sort of leads to and moves away from triple meter. I think all meters are good and useful at any point whenever you need them. So I don't think there's anything special about like 3/4 versus 4/4 that makes it where everything's leading. 3/4 is waltz. So that's why we're using it. But let me scroll down here. Okay. So I think I may have gotten all the questions because everybody's just kind of chatting with themselves. If anybody has other questions, please go ahead and post them. And if you posted it like a long time ago and I didn't get to it, maybe repost it so I can see it down at the bottom. I wish there was a way to, there may be a way to separate questions from just the chat. So we may have to look at that. Let's see. So I'm going to go ahead and save that real quick. So yeah, please post your questions and we'll continue with the live broadcast of the Art of Composing show. No. Opinions on Bruckner versus Mahler. Mahler, 100%. Mahler actually took counterpoint lessons from Bruckner, although when I was reading the biography, the records show that he frequently skipped Bruckner's counterpoint classes. But Bruckner just hasn't resonated with me. I think often it feels like there's a little bit of a lack of clarity in Bruckner's writing for me, that it's sometimes the sound is a little bit washed out. Now, it could be the recordings that I listen to, and I haven't gone on a big hunt for Bruckner. But I just, whenever I've listened to it, it's nice. There's nothing inherently wrong about it. It hasn't resonated with me all that much. So, and often, if you ask me, in fact, let me switch here. If you ask me, like 90% of composers against Mahler, I'm probably just going to say Mahler. So, I like Mahler. What can I say? So, were there any opinions on Note Performer? I'm curious if other people have liked it. Oh, good. David's asking my analysis of Mahler Symphony Number 6. I analyze it to be very good. I haven't done a full-on analysis. If you can see here, I am working through it right now. And I had all sorts of big plans yesterday morning that I was like, I'm going to make my way through the Andante, so the third movement, or sometimes the second movement, depending on how you look at it. Mahler changed it, actually, after the original performance. But I made it, like, 8 bars in, and I got so enamored with, like, the first 8 bars that I just stopped there. I spent, like, an hour on that because I started coming up with questions about it. You know, let me go ahead and pull it up for a second so we can see it. And let's see. So that's movement number one. There we go. Okay, so I've got movement three up, and that's movement one. Give me a second here, because I got to change what this window's looking at. There we go. So we are looking at movement number three, the Andante. And to give you a little bit of perspective, hopefully I can play this, and you can listen to it. So give me 1 second, Mahler Symphony. Super quiet. Hold on. Let's see. So maybe the Bernstein one's a little bit louder. Okay, is that... just let me know if that's not loud enough. I'm just going to keep playing. So that's enough to get the point across. And so what I was really excited about when I was looking at this, one, obviously, it's very beautiful music. I mean, it's just very emotional, very longing. I think the way he's... Let me go to a nicer piano sound. I think the way he's written this melody is really interesting. I mean, it's in E-flat, right? Piano's muted, that's why. So you got this melody going on. And of course I miss it. Right, so if we look at this is a flat two, right? You've got the E going up to G, but then when he comes back down, so it's like a mixture of just normal major and Phrygian, that Phrygian sound, this kind of, right? It kind of feels like, almost like that Spanish-y kind of sound, but it doesn't make it sound Spanish. He just makes it sound like different. I don't know. It's this really kind of unique way of writing. And he goes back and forth with these things. Here you've got, so we're back to a kind of a natural two. And he's playing with that minor third, right, going into the major third. And this is all throughout the symphony. I mean, if you look often, in fact, in the first movement, you'll hear the trumpets come in, right, doing that sound right there. This symphony, he's always playing around with minor thirds and major thirds, and they're just going back and forth. So melodically, just very interesting, you know, harmonically, very interesting. But when what I really opened it up was to look at the orchestration, and I'm trying to think about every time now when I'm looking at scores, how is the brain actually hearing this stuff? You know, how are you perceiving this music? Now, obviously, right? That's the primary element. You listen and. And that's the thing that sticks out the most. But I would say that kind of the secondary thing that you're supposed to be listening to is... Now, I'm calling them primary and secondary because they have the most movement, you know, and they're the things that do stick out. What I was interested with, though, and it seems so plain and simple, is why did Mahler write this in the violas, right? Why does he have... effectively you know, just sustained notes. Right. Now you don't get the same effect on the piano. I mean, I play it with the strings here, but it's going to sound harsh. But these, if you look, they kind of sit in the middle of everything that's going on. I mean, you've got this B flat right here is, if you were on the violins, it's the B flat at the bottom of the staff, right? So it would be down about, I don't know if you can see my mouse actually. So, but it would be that B flat 3 if you're thinking about the octave number, with C4 being middle C. And they're almost inaudible. And in fact, even last night, I was specifically listening for this. You just can't even perceive. You can see them playing. But what they're really acting as is like a binding agent. It's like a glue between this and this. And then, of course, you got the bass kind of giving you those pizzicato hits that just, they ground you. They're like, it's like you build up static electricity and then this goes blah and it kind of grounds you for the moment. The reason I spent so long on this yesterday is because I started experimenting within Sibelius. And I was trying out, like, okay, if I were to give this rhythm, right? If I matched the rhythm here, would it blend even more or less? And it blended about the same. And I think it's obviously it's very quiet, but you just don't even perceive it. It really blends together as one single stream, but then it could also blend together as one single stream here almost. It's like the background noise. Now, this is something I'm dealing with when I'm coming up with my ideas about orchestration and streams. I talked a little bit about it last week, where your brain can only perceive three individual streams, auditory streams at a time, right? Everything else becomes incoherent background noise. That is not to say that it's not necessary for the composition. And this is a critical point to make with it, is you may absolutely want it. Because what it does is it acts as a softening agent or like a diffusing agent for these things, right? It adds more frequencies in the spectrum over your ears. You're listening to all of it. You're not just listening to this. You're not just listening to this. But it really bridges the gap. If you just play... And actually on the piano, the piano naturally kind of fills these in with the pedal and everything. Not so much in Sibelius's piano, but if you played on a baby grand or an upright or something, you'll see that pressing the pedal actually automatically does this. And if you've ever heard the phrase, the orchestra has no pedal, what it really is implying that you're not getting these overtones naturally being excited like you do on the piano. You have to actively excite these overtones. You have to fill up the harmonic space. I'm not going to say you have to. You have the option to, obviously. He could have very well just done underneath and... He could have just done that, and it would have been fine, but it would have felt a little bit thinner. And I think it was just through experience, he knew this has to thicken up. So as I went through yesterday, I'll show you a little bit of this. What I'm doing is I'm marking down where do the streams begin and where do the streams end. And you can see the red line is really one continuous stream. But this one, I started as green. I was like, oh, I think it's part of this stream here. But really, I colored it in gray afterwards. It was like, actually, it's kind of just like a background noise grayness that adds richness to the air, adds a little bit of, just a little bit more frequency in the room, a little bit more excitement on all the instruments. So I just started playing around with it, changing around, seeing if I could mess with his orchestration a little bit. Now, I don't get the full effect, but I was messing around with it with a note performer, but you do get a little bit of it. You can really experiment, and this is something that I would recommend, just like I recommend copying out pieces by hand, and obviously analyzing pieces and analyzing your own music. Take a section like this, write it out in your music notation software, whatever it is. I use Sibelius, but if you're using MuseScore, MuseScore, you don't really have great sounds with it. Sibelius with Note Performer is really good, but you can also do this in your DAW and mess around with it. Just, take things out, add things in, try to make it different and still work. Try to break it. Try to make it not work. See what makes it not work. See what is going on under the hood. And I really believe you'll learn a whole lot. You know, it's through these little experiments that you really come up with new and interesting ways to do things. So that's something, you know, we have to step back and think about how should we as composers be using our technology. And we have amazing technology now. I mean, we've got things that are just so incredibly powerful, it can be overwhelming. But it's also important to realize that we have built-in technology, we have a brain, and probably most of the music that you know, I'm not going to say that you consider great. Most of the music that I consider to be great music has been written by hand with usually no more than a piano, and then they go at it at the first performance. That's a lot of risk, right? That feels very scary and risky. However, they worked on this muscle right here, the brain muscle, right? They worked it out, and they practice writing their music without the aid of Sibelius, without the aid of a DAW, without, you know, Spitfire samples, which I have the Spitfire strings, by the way, which are quite amazing. I highly recommend, if you're going to get a string library, Spitfire stuff just always sounds so great to me. Nonetheless, think about really what it is as a composer you want to work on and what's going to pay off the most. Is it going to pay off the most for you to figure out how to mix your music better? Maybe, depending on where you're at. 6 months ago, that was absolutely what I needed more than anything else. I was like, I really need to work on my mixing. So I took a mixing class and I feel like I learned a ton. At this point, I've got it down. I don't need to go beyond that because I don't want to be a mixer. I want to be a composer. And so I need to work on the skills and the techniques that composers need to have mastered. I've mastered Sibelius to the point where I can usually do everything I need to. I'm learning Dorico right now. But what I really need to master is my brain. I need to master the abilities that I have to come up with unique and interesting ideas. And I'm going to use the technology that I have to get to that end. I'm going to play around with ideas in Sibelius and work them out here. And then I'm going to try to get them in the hands of real players and see how it all turns out. So, that's I don't even remember how I got onto that. But either way. I was talking about Symphony 6 and my analysis of it. I don't have a full analysis of the symphony yet. However, there are some good things out there. I would highly recommend Mahler's Symphonic Sonatas by a guy named Monahan. What's his first name? Let's see if we can... Seth Monahan. I'm reading through it right now, and it is really good. I really enjoy it. If you've read anything on classical form, and in particular, if you've read Sonata Theory, right, by Hepikoski and Darcy, or if you're like me and you've had trouble reading Sonata Theory by Hepikoski and Darcy, because it's a very large book and can actually be pretty confusing, I feel like he puts the ideas into really good perspective for you, and you can really learn a whole lot. And actually, let me just give you a little bit of advice that I've found when trying to venture into new theory books or new theories. I would go over to Music Theory Online, and I would go to Google Scholar, and I would look up a review of a book, because often the reviews summarize the ideas. They tell you potential issues that you're going to have to look out for as you're reading, and they'll usually tell you the strongest points of the theory. So if you've got a book that you're just like itching to read, right? William Kaplan's classical form, or Sonata Theory, or, you know, Seth Monahan's book, or whatever it is, Google to see if there is a review by somebody so that you can get a sense of what the book is about. And I'm not just talking Amazon reviews, because often Amazon reviews are just like, I liked it or I didn't like it. But I'm talking like a real peer-reviewed review that'll go in something like Music Theory Online or Music Theory Spectrum, their print magazine. So that's just something that's like a little thing that I've picked up on. Often you can make a quick call about whether that book is going to be right for you right now to read, or if you can kind of shelve it and come back to it at a later date. Let's see. focus, Mr. Bjarke, or Bjarke, I don't know how to say your name, I apologize, but you ask about the 10,000 hour rule and whether it's true. I mean, I've got no reason to think that it's not true. Beyond reading Malcolm Gladwell's book, if you're interested in that stuff, the guy who actually did all the research, his name is K. Anders Ericsson. And I would highly recommend looking at some of his papers. You can usually find them online for free because a lot of this academic stuff is just posted freely online. And you can really get into the nitty-gritty about what all this means. And he recently put out a book as well on expertise and reaching the points where we all want to, you know, reach mastery. Speaking of which, Mastery is also a good book by Robert Greene, and he talks a little bit about it. I think one of the critical aspects of the 10,000-hour rule is that you are doing deliberate practice that is actually hard and slightly painful for your brain. You know, if you're doing the same hour for 10,000 hours, then you're not going to make any progress. And in fact, I was in a former life, I was a scout helicopter pilot in the Army, and one of my instructor pilots, he would point to some guy that had 5,000-6,000 hours, and then he would say, that guy is not a great pilot because he's flown the same hour 6,000 times. You know, maybe he was an instructor pilot for a for beginners or something. And he says, you got to fly a different hour every hour. If you're not pushing yourself, you're not going to grow. And the name of the game is growth and change and improvement. So just sit down and work really hard on what you know you need to work on. Yes, I am familiar also with deep work by Cal Newport. And I actually recently have started trying to group my week into ways that I can get more into deep work. So what I realized over the last couple of months is my deep work often is actually thinking. What I do on Art of Composing is... Did I lose my mic here? Test. No. The thing stopped lighting up for me. I don't know. There's been something up with my audio today. So I apologize to everybody that my audio's freaking out a little bit. But I've been trying to get ahead of emails, so I have Minutia Monday, which is my day to basically go through emails, go through all the things that I have to get through during the week so that later in the week, so I get to Wednesdays, and Wednesdays is Deep Work Wednesdays. Thursdays is Thinking Thursdays, right? And Friday is Free Form Friday for me. I basically get to work on and do whatever I want as long as it's related to something actually practical for my life and something I actually need to accomplish. So try it out. If it's been working for me recently, especially I've been getting ahead of my email, which is a big deal. For the first time in like months, I'm looking at my email. It's almost inbox zero. So that's a big deal for me. So are there any last minute questions? I actually have a question for you guys. Anybody that has been through, I see you were talking about the Hans Zimmer masterclass. I am curious about it. I haven't paid or signed up for it yet. But I would like to know if you think it's been worth it and very good. I want to learn from everybody, and I think this is something that we can all, as a philosophy, try to take on, is that everybody is better at you than, or everybody is better at something than you are, right? And Hans Zimmer, my audio just spiked. I just saw it was like crazy spike there. I don't know what happened. Hans Zimmer, obviously, is a better film composer than me in the sense of he's scored way more films. He's written amazing music that a lot of people love to listen to, and we can learn something from that. And it may not necessarily be that you're going to pick up on his style, right? It may not be that you're going to emulate the way he works. It just could be philosophical points. You know, you may hate the way I write music and you don't want to do it, but you could learn something philosophically from me. And I think we all need to take the approach of everybody has something to teach and you just have to listen for it. You just have to look for it. If you think it's been good, let me know, because I am curious about it. But Let's see. Jersey's asking some clues, ideas, or tips for improving or use of the alto or tenor clefs. Transpose it to treble clef because I hate the alto. No, I'm kidding. You just have to use it. I mean, I'm getting better. I'm not a great alto or tenor. I'm terrible at tenor clef. I'm not going to lie. Alto clef, I'm getting okay-ish at, but it's something I just didn't grow up using. I remember the first time I tried to play piano and I was reading music. I'm like, why does this sound so terrible? And then at some point, I figured out that the bass clef is different from the treble clef, and then it all started clicking for me. So you just have to do it. One thing, though, that I must say is that if you can tie it to something physical, right? So if you want to learn the viola, that's great. But if you can tie it to some kind of playing on the instrument, maybe practice playing with the alto clef. I've noticed that when I'm thinking of notes, I will use trumpet fingerings, right? I will actually, you know, pretend as if I'm playing, you know, C, D, E, F, G, F sharp, you know, whatever. I will actually kind of pretend play the trumpet. And it is a great way to connect those notes to your body and to actually for things to make sense. So yeah. Now, since I sang, is there one every Saturday? I've actually changed the times on things. So I alternate now Fridays and Saturdays. I do one a week. Next week's going to be Friday at 5 p.m. Pacific time. I'm out in California. And then the following week will be Saturday. So if you're curious, go to artofcomposing.com/composer-symposium. I probably have to pick a better name. I know. But it's actually kind of a weird name, and it probably sticks in your mind a little bit better. But, yeah, if you just go to the site, check out the symposium page, that should have when the next one's going to be happening. I try to update it at least a couple days before. So, but Fridays or Saturdays, just so get it in your week. If you put it in your calendar every 2 weeks, starting now or, you know, starting at 11 a.m. on Saturday today, if you get it repeating every 2 weeks, then you'll know at least when the Saturday one is. Next week, Friday, 5 p.m. If there's any last-minute questions, please submit it now. I'm going ahead and make my little pitch, my spiel for Art of Composing Academy. Please check it out. I've put my heart and soul into the Music Composition 101 and 201 courses. They are foundational. They teach pretty much not everything I know, because I've learned a lot. I did the 101 course like 2 years ago, so I've learned a lot since then. But I taught pretty much everything I know back then. So they're good stuff, and they're very thorough. And if you are interested in learning how to compose, or if you're already a composer and you want to just get a more solid foundation, then I highly recommend it. So go ahead, artofcomposing.com, check it out. Salvador is saying, can you say something about the hammer? Yes, the hammer is amazing. If you've never experienced a Mahler hammer in person, then you are missing out. Mahler, when he wrote the symphony, designed a giant wooden hammer to be hammered onto a giant wooden box, and it's supposed to be these death blows that are dealt to the hero in the fourth movement, and they are very powerful. Now, it can be, sometimes when you watch it, you're like, this is a little bit silly. And I think he was really doing it for shock effect. I mean, the final blow is actually not the hammer. It's like just the big bass drum blow. It's like, wah, you know, that's probably a little more powerful. The hammer is kind of a sharper sound. It's a little bit higher, you know, spectral centroid. But yeah, check out the Mahler hammer videos online. They're some of them are pretty funny. And actually, there's some, like, fails where guys, like, miss the box or, you know, things happen. So, yeah, real quick, Ilka's asking about the augmented six chord. So an augmented six chord is a chord that, let me pull up a piano here. Augmented six chord sounds like, let me just delete all this. It sounds like a seventh chord, right? But it's a lie. It's not a seventh chord. It is an augmented sixth chord. So if we were to do a non-augmented sixth chord, right? Do something like that, right? You got, right, this would be a sixth chord. Let me get Okay, so if we were to look at just a normal six chord, right? And I'm saying six in terms of inversion. Right, you've got A flat on the bottom, C, F. Now if we were to augment that six chord, you get this sound. Now in reality, this is enharmonic, right? There's no difference in the actual sound. And I know people can try to make cases about there was a difference with Mozart and his piano and the way the tuning, and not that important. The point is that nowadays with equal temperament, there's effectively no difference in the sound. But there is a difference in the way that this resolves. So if we were to make this a seventh chord, right? Where does this want to go? That wants to go down. Right? And it goes to... So that would be a traditional, you know, the resolution of a seventh chord, like that. With an augmented six, on the other hand, you've got a sharp up there. And sharps usually want to go up, and flats usually want to go down. And where that leads you, right, is here, is a G and a G in this case, right? One goes up, one goes up or down. So you've got... Now, we have different kinds of augmented six chords. This would be considered an Italian six chord. It's a triad, right? You've got A flat, C, F sharp here. And this will frequently go often kind of minor. Or sorry, yeah. And the reason is because if you don't want to have too much parallel movement of things, so let's say you want to have as little voice leading as possible. So Ashton says the German six is the greatest. I think the French people would disagree with you. But no, that was just a joke. It's not a very funny joke. You want to try to hold over notes if possible, and you want to try to avoid parallels. Now, the other ones, this is, of course, a German six, right? It sounds like just a normal straight-up full seventh chord. This one pretty much has to go here, and the reason is because if you were to go to the five chord, right, the Italian six, I believe, can go to a five chord without any major issues. But if you were to go to a five chord here, if we strip all these away, you get parallel movement, right? So that's what we're trying to avoid. Now, the French six is like this, and it's actually not a six chord in the sense of a first inversion chord. It's a 4-3 chord, right? And this one we usually go straight to a five chord, right? And the reason that works like that is because you've got this D sustained between the two. So I need to come up with an American six because, no. So I'm tired of French and German and Italian six. Why do they get a six chord and we don't get a six chord? It's not, no. Another terrible joke. I just need to quit for the day. So. Okay. Well, if anybody else, if there's any last-minute questions, I think an hour and a half is probably good. My voice is not quite completely trashed yet, but it's feeling there. It's kind of dry and itchy. So, no other questions? Anybody? No? Okay. Well, then I think we will call it. I apologize if you're writing your stuff right now, and I think there's a little bit of a delay between when people write and when it actually shows up in the chat. But thank you, everybody, for showing up, and I hope to see you next week at the next Friday one. Orlando's asking, what resources do you recommend for learning music theory? Artofcomposing.com. No, there's a bunch. Music theory... there's a site, if you just Google music theory, there's like a bazillion of them. So, okay. Well, I will see everybody next week. Next week, of course, Friday at 5 p.m. is going to be the next one. And I may start doing more of these. We'll see. I'm enjoying this. What I really like about the Google Live is that I don't edit anything. It's just live. So it's just done when I'm done, which is really nice. So, okay. I'll see everybody next week. Later.